Perfect. I've also put a view of Google Maps on the slide, so I'm obviously not from Israel. I'm from Germany, and I'm going to talk about the execute around pointer. So I first put a small timeline here about some key events of C++. So it's not everything, but it contains the major releases we had in the past about 20 years, from C++ 03 to C++ 20 recently. But there's actually also an event in the far past that gets mentioned only rarely. So in 1979, Jano started his work on serious classes. And 1 year later, he added a feature to the language with the name call and return functions, which got removed later on. I couldn't find when it what got removed, but it got removed. And what the feature was about is that you could, as member functions, define a function with the name call that took no arguments and returned void, and you could define a member function called return. So return was not only the keyword to return from a function, like it was inherited from C, but you could also define a member function with that name. And then the compiler injected a call to the call function before every member function call that you do, and a call to the return function after every member function call that you do on an object. The language feature got removed from serious classes and also from C++. And today I'm going to talk about how we can actually achieve something similar as a library feature. So the motivation is to wrap the calls to an object in the pairs of prefix code and afterwards suffix code. And of course, it should be simple and reusable and a general solution. It will be non-intrusive, so you can put it on top of every other object that you have without having to change it. And an example that we'll also see in the end is how you can automatically lock and unlock a mutex around each member function call such that you can have a thread-safe access in some multi-threaded environment. And yeah, I've put some code here in the end of the slide how it should look like. We have the prefix action, can be a function or some lambda object. We have the suffix object, is also a lambda. We're going to wrap a std string. That's the object that we're going to wrap. And then we can create an execute around pointer, which then takes a raw pointer in this case. It takes the prefix action, the suffix action. And now if we're going to call functions on the wrapper with the arrow operator, so we can call wrapper arrow assign, then the compiler will turn that actually into calling the prefix, calling object.assign, and calling the suffix afterwards. Okay, and there are two language features that we have to know about to get this working. The first one is the temporary object lifetime. So when you have a temporary object constructed, then it actually gets destructed at the end of an expression. So if you have multiple temporary objects, then they are of course destructed in reverse order. And there are also some exceptions to that rule, like for example, if you're binding in const L value reference or an R value reference, then you can keep the temporary object living. But in general, it gets destroyed at the end of an expression. So in my terminology, that's typically the semicolon, the end of an expression. And yeah, there's an example. We have a type called trace, which prints ctor in the constructor and dtor in the destructor, has a member function called f, which just prints f. And in the main function, we now print first one, then we construct a temporary trace object, call f, and afterwards print two. And if we execute that program, then the output is one ctor f ditor two, which probably is to no surprise. But it's how we learned it, right? It's how the language is designed. But I mean, they they could have designed it different that, for example, the temporary object would live till the end of its of a scope, but that's not how it's working. So the temporary object gets destroyed at the end of the expression. The second language feature that we have to know about is operator overloading, especially overloading the operator arrow. So you can, as member functions and also as free functions, overload certain operators. The operator arrow can only be overloaded as member function. And if you do so, if you overload it, then the operator arrow will be called again on the value that it returns recursively till you return a raw pointer. And when you return a raw pointer in the end, finally, then the built-in semantics are applied to that raw pointer and reference, dereference the pointer and give you the object that it points to. So in this example here, we have a struct inner, which contains a string and overloads the operator arrow to return a string raw pointer. We have a struct outer, which contains the inner, which contains an object of type inner, and also overloads the operator arrow to return a reference to the inner. And if you know in a main function, construct an object outer and call outer arrow assign then, then the compiler will translate it into first calling the operator arrow on the outer object, which gives us an inner reference, and then on that inner object, calling the operator arrow again to get a raw pointer and then to apply built-in semantics there. You can actually play around with this. If you, for example, don't return a pointer in the end, then you will get a compiler error because in the end, there always have to be a raw pointer. Yeah, and now we're going to put that together to build the class executor on pointer. So it's a class template. As first argument, we get the pointer that we are executing around. The second template argument is the prefix action that we want to execute. And the third argument is the suffix action. We then store a pointer, PTR. We store the prefix action, P, and the suffix action, S. You can construct then an execute around pointer from a pointer, a prefix action, and a suffix action. So this is not about perfect forwarding or how you should write a constructor. It's just that we want to keep it simple on that slide. We have these three objects, the pointer, the prefix, and the suffix, and we're just going to pass it there. And then we overload the operator arrow in the, and the first thing we do is we call the prefix action. And the next thing that we do is that we return a call proxy object. So a temporary object here, which is also templated, but in this time we use pointer ref and suffix ref, just to avoid possibly copying expensive suffix actions, or maybe to avoid copying the pointer type if, for example, it would be a shared pointer. So you don't have to use a raw pointer as pointer, as template argument. It could be also a shared pointer, or actually any type that overloads the operator arrow and participates in this recursive chaining of the operator arrow. How does the call proxy class look like? So it's templated on a pointer and a suffix. Also just stores the pointer PTR and the suffix S. We construct it from the pointer PTR and the suffix S. And now we again overload the operator arrow to return the pointer now. And we have a user provided destructor where we call the suffix action. So when the temporary call proxy object gets destroyed, the suffix action gets executed. We delete the copy constructor, which also automatically deletes the move operations. And this is important because you want your call proxy object to only be called once, right? If you, you want the suffix action to be only executed once. So if you have a call proxy object and would copy it, then there would be the destructor would be called twice, once for the original object, once for the copy, and you only want your suffix action to be called once. This requires C++17, so the mandatory copy elision, because we're actually returning a call proxy object, right, from the operator error from the execute around pointer. So to be able to return the object without having copy or move constructors defined requires the copy elision. And there are also solutions for pre-C++ 17, but they are slightly more complex and I won't cover them now. But having that put all together, we can now again put the example from the beginning here, where prefix and suffix are two lambda objects. We are just wrapping a raw string pointer. And if we now call wrapper arrow assign, what under the hood all happens is that we first call the arrow operator on our execute around pointer. There we first execute the prefix action. We then return a call proxy object, the temporary object, which also overloads operator arrow. So the compiler again calls that operator arrow. That one returns the raw pointer. So the compiler applies the built-in semantics here to dereference that raw pointer and calls assign on it. So this is where the member function now happens. Then the temporary call proxy goes out of scope at the end of the expression, and in its destructor, he calls the suffix function. And that's how you how you can wrap the member function in these pair of prefix and suffix code. Another use case, or a real use case now, would be to have an object that you want to lock and unlock, where you want to lock and unlock every access with a mutex. So we first construct the mutex M, and in our prefix and suffix action now we capture a reference to that mutex. The prefix action locks, the suffix action unlocks. And now if we create an execute around pointer, we again pass the prefix and suffix action. And now we have a lambda, an action, just some example code that we are going to execute asynchronously. And that action iterates from 0 to 100 and just operates on the wrapper. So we call pushback C there. And next thing is that we create an array. So four times we start an asynchronous execution of action now. In a loop, we wait for all the four async actions. And in the end, when we print the size, it's guaranteed to be 400 because every access to the object is locked and unlocked between the prefix and suffix action. So the conclusion is that we use the constructor and destructor of a temporary object to wrap a member function call by prefix and suffix code. In our example, we use the operator arrow of the execute around pointer where we call the prefix. So it's technically not the constructor of the temporary object, but you would also put it there. We execute the operator arrow recursively to first return a temporary object, and from that temporary object, then return the wrapped object. The solution is more or less simple. It's reusable and non-intrusive, but you have to be aware of some limitations. So you have no access to the called member functions, and you don't have access to any arguments or the result of the function. And you have to do the access via the operator arrow. Yeah, so as last slide, the references. I found this idiom on wikibox.org under execute around pointer. That's why I named it that way, because I learned it under that name. But actually, Bjarne also wrote a paper about it in the June 2000 called Wrapping C++ Member Function Calls. Yeah, and that's it. Thank you.